Well, today is a great day. I'm excited about having lunch after the service. I can hardly pay attention to what I'm saying. So I'm so thankful for our Korean brothers and sisters who are giving this as a gift, as an expression of thanks, and we're going to be celebrating together with them after the service. So we've been talking the last several weeks about the essentials for new life in the new year. So we've been talking about different topics, some of the big topics that we've been addressing in the book of James. We looked at temptations and trials, recognizing that we all face them. We all deal with trials and temptations in our life. Thankfully, we have a big God, a God who provides for us, who we want to know the impact of climate change. We're trying to make predictions about who's going to be the next prime minister. You probably tried to predict who's going to be the U.S. president and probably got it wrong. We want to know what's going to happen in the future. And so we go to, people go to fortune tellers, they get their palms read, they look at fortune cookies and astrology, all those kind of things, because we want to know what's going to happen in the future. And we go to seminars and we read books about how to plan and how to prepare for the future. So the question is, how, as Christians, should we think about the future? How should we, what is our attitude towards the future? What should we think about it? And so James talks about this in this passage in chapter 4. And he says there are really three common mistakes that we often make when it comes to thinking about the future. And so he gives these as warnings to us. So he starts off with an illustration. Maybe he's actually heard this conversation happen before. It's between two businessmen, and one of them likely is somebody who got an MBA from University of Jerusalem or something, and another guy is a CEO of a Tel Aviv 500 company, and they're having a conversation about what they want to do in the future. And we get an idea what this conversation is like. And so in verse 13 of chapter 4, James says, "Look here, you who say, today or tomorrow we are going to a certain town and will stay there a year. We will do business there and make a profit." So this is a conversation that's happening between two businessmen, real entrepreneurs, real go-getters. These are people that have a plan. They know when, it's, you know, today or tomorrow. They know the where in a certain city. They know the how long, they're going to stay there for a year or so. They know the what, they're going to carry on business. They know the why, well, they want to make money. I mean, this is what they're planning. And so when you look at this, is there anything that says that it's wrong? Is there anything wrong here? Do you see anything that causes you to question? Because the Bible doesn't say there's anything wrong with business. It doesn't say there's anything wrong with making money. As long as, of course, you're not oppressing people or doing it illegally or anything like that. But the Bible doesn't condemn this. So what's wrong here? And so James says that the first mistake that we often make when it comes to the future is this: that you often plan without God. We're making plans without considering God at all. In fact, you don't see any mention of God in this business plan at all. He's nowhere to be found. And so these guys knew what they wanted to do, but there's no mention of seeing what God wants them to do. They didn't check out with God at all. Now, I don't want to make you think that I'm suggesting that planning is wrong, because the Bible actually has a lot to say about the importance of planning. Jesus himself says in Luke 14, he says, "No man goes out and builds a house without first considering how much it's going to cost." So we do need to plan. We do need to prepare. If you look at the book of Proverbs, it's full of verses that talk about you're a fool if you don't plan. So the Bible's not condemning planning whatsoever. But what James is saying is here, there's a problem that when you do plan and you don't include God, planning without God is a big problem. Now, it's good to have dreams and to have goals and to think about the future and where you want to go, but as long as you include God in this, as long as you're praying about it, as long as you're involving him in the decisions and the planning of this. And so James is saying that these people, their attitude is one of self-sufficiency. That they're thinking about themselves and themselves alone. Now, Brad Pitt, who many of you recognize as a famous actor, wealthy, successful actor. A lot of people get, it's very embarrassing, they always get him confused with myself. But anyways, he just went through a nasty divorce, as you know, also to equally famous wife Angelina Jolie. Many of you probably don't know that Brad Pitt actually grew up in a Christian home. He grew up in a Christian home, and he was talking about that aspect. Just a few years ago, there was an interview, and he's trying to distance himself from it, and this is what he says: "I found my Christian upbringing very stifling. I always had a lot of questions about the world. A big question for me was fairness. If I'd grown up in some other religion, would I get the same shot at heaven as a Christian has?" And then listen to what he says here: "When I got untethered from the comfort of religion, it wasn't a loss of faith for me, it was a discovery of self. I had faith that I'm capable enough to handle any situation. There's peace in understanding that I only have one life here and now, and I'm responsible." So there's an attitude of self-sufficiency. And I don't want to pick on Brad Pitt, but he just articulated what a lot of people are thinking and doing in their life right now. There's a great deal of focus on independence, of entitlement, of empowerment. I think the selfie stick is just a natural progression of how we view ourselves. That we are self-sufficient. We are looking after ourselves. That's the focus. Many of you probably will be aware of Google that is scanning all of the published books from the 1500s to today. This is a big project, and you can actually go in and do some searching on these books. And researchers have been doing this, and they're noticing something interesting in this regard. And this one journalist went through it, and he discovered that there is a dramatic rise in the last 50 years on the whole area of individualism. The words, the language that is being used in published books over the last 50 years is increasingly getting words like self, personalized, I come first, I can do it myself, as opposed to other words that were much more common before: community, share, band together, common good. So the prevailing attitude that we are immersed ourselves in our culture, is one of self-sufficiency, self-reliance. And here's the reality: that just because you call yourself a believer in Christ, just because you come to church on a Sunday morning, you call yourself a believer, doesn't mean that you are actually relying upon God in your life. You can talk the talk and you can go to church, but still not even include God in your life. That you can forget that God is actually there, that He is actually interested in your plans, that He wants to be involved, that He wants you to see that He is in charge. And so we actually end up becoming practical atheists, functional atheists. Even though you believe in God but not include Him in our plans, we're functional atheists. You know, it's sad when somebody doesn't, when they say they don't believe in God, but it's even sadder when somebody says, I believe in God, but then forget about Him and don't include Him. Live their life as though He doesn't exist. Just go on our own, as if everything depends upon ourselves. And so if you say you believe in God, does He have a say in your life? Does He have a say in your business, in your education, in your plans for the future? Does He have a say? Some people may say, well, I don't believe in mixing faith and business. Well, if you're a Christian, everything you do is God's business. So planning without God is practical atheism. So what's the solution? The solution is simply to include God in all of your goal setting. Verse 15, James says, what you ought to say is, if the Lord wants us to, we will live and do this or that. So James is talking about the attitude of relying upon God, trusting in Him in everything that you are doing and the plans that you have. Notice the word if. If the Lord wants. And we recognize that there is a lot of unpredictability about life. The word if is in the word life itself. Life can be iffy. It can be unpredictable. And so we don't know what's going to happen tonight or tomorrow. We can make some guesses about that, but we can't actually know for sure. So planning without God is presumptuous. So really the starting point for us is to say, okay, God, what do you want me to do? What do you want me to not do? You're asking God ahead of time, asking him in advance, what is it that you want me to do? And then when we make those plans, James says he wants us to say with the attitude that if the Lord wills, and you probably know people that do that, Lord willing, right? You've probably heard that phrase. And you say, well, can't that just be a cliche? Well, yeah, it can. It can be a cliche. But James is talking about the attitude that we have. Lord willing. Lord willing, we are going to be doing this or doing that. It's the attitude that we need to have. It's up to God, ultimately, what the future holds. Actually, for hundreds of years, Christians used to sign their letters with the initials DV. DV was the initials of the Latin phrase Deo Volenti. God willing is what it meant. So for years, they were doing that. And it became, unfortunately, it became a sense of which, well, if you're really pious, then you would have DV at every letter, right? And so you're kind of probably became more of a cliche, and that's probably why it doesn't, it's not done anymore. But God willing, this is the attitude that we are having, that if it is God's will, what is God included in your plans? Proverbs 16 says, we may make our plans, but God has the last word. And verse 9 of the same chapter, we should make our plans counting on God to direct us. So our attitude is, don't make plans and say, okay, God, can you bless my plans? I mean, that really is practical atheism. You haven't included him in anything. You're already going ahead with doing what you're planning and then asking God to bless it. And so rather we should say, God, what direction do you want me to go? Where are you blessing? Where are you moving? How do you want me to join what you are already doing? So planning without God is the first mistake that James talks about, and we overcome that by including God in all of our goal setting, all of our plans. Second mistake that James talks about is presuming about tomorrow. Taking tomorrow for granted. Thinking that we're going to live forever, that there's no, we've got the rest of our life. Verse 14, it says, how do you know what your life will be like tomorrow? Your life is like the morning fog. It is here a little while, then it's gone. You are boasting about your own pretentious plans, and all such boasting is evil. Now, there's a couple of reasons why we need to be careful about not presuming about tomorrow. The first one is that the fact that we already mentioned that life is unpredictable. He says, how do you know? How do you know? None of us know what's going to happen. We don't know what's going to happen tomorrow, let alone next week or next year. I mean, we can guess, but we just don't know. I mean, there could be a war. There could be the economy could collapse. Our friends could leave. I mean, there's all kinds of things that can happen that we just don't know. It's unpredictable. And some of you who are self-employed know that level of unpredictability. I mean, it can happen any time, right? You just never know. Or there could be, there's just no guarantees of success. But I don't want to emphasize this to the degree that would cause anxiety or worry in your life. This is not what God is trying to do. He doesn't want you to be afraid of the future just because it's unpredictable. But he just let it cause you to have more deeper dependence upon God, trusting in him more and more. Secondly, life is brief. He says, your life is like the morning fog. And that word fog comes from the Greek word atmos, which is where we get the English word atmosphere. And we all know how fog is, right? It can come in the mornings. We had fog this past week, and then, by noon, it disappears. And so we don't know how long we're going to live. It comes and it disappears. The Bible has all kinds of words to describe our life. It uses phrases like leaf, grass, shadow, cloud, puff of smoke, vapor. I mean, this is how God is describing our life. It's like it can come and it can disappear so quickly. Life is short. It goes so fast. And so we need to be careful that we don't presume about the future, because we can't take tomorrow for granted. Isaiah 56:12, an interesting verse, says, "Come," they say, "let's get some wine, let's have a party, let's all get drunk. Then tomorrow we'll do it all again, have an even bigger party." And so I don't know if you know people like this. I mean, they just want to party. They're just presuming on tomorrow that they'll be able to continue to do this, or that income will come in some ways. They're presuming upon tomorrow, believing that they are going to live forever. And James says this is a dumb attitude to have, that we can't presume that we're going to live forever. Proverbs 27 verse 1 says, "Don't brag about tomorrow, since you don't know what the day will bring." So there's nothing wrong with making plans for the future. In fact, it's important that we do that. But announcing our goals for the future can be one of two things. They can either be a statement of faith, or trusting in God, or it can be a statement of arrogance. "I've got everything under control. I know what I'm going to do. I've planned it out thoroughly. I have all the gifts and abilities that this is going to get accomplished." It can either be a statement of faith, or it can be a statement of arrogance, based upon your attitude and your trust in God. So, what is the solution to not presuming on tomorrow? The solution is to live one day at a time. Matthew 6:34, Jesus says, "So don't be anxious about tomorrow. God will take care of your tomorrow too. Live one day at a time." So how should we be thinking about the future? We should be thinking, living one day at a time. The future can sometimes be overwhelming, right? If you've experienced that. I mean, if I look back on seasons in my life where I've gone through some trials or some difficulties, and if I had known in advance what I was going to go through, I would have probably been overwhelmed. And so God doesn't need for us to know in advance all of these things. He says, live one day at a time. Trust Him in this day. We can have all that we need from God for the day that we are facing. And besides, the other thing to remember is today is the day 15 years from now we're going to look back at and say, "Oh, remember those good old days from 2017, right? We do that. We look back and say, "Wow, those are great years, right?" And so enjoy the days that you have and live one day at a time. All right, a third common mistake is putting off doing good. Putting off doing good. Verse 17, James says this, "Remember, it is sin to know what you ought to do and then not do it." So he's talking about procrastination. He's talking about, you know, you should be doing this, but I know I should be doing this, but I'll do it the next day, or I'll do it another time. I intend to do this. I'm aiming to do this, but it never actually gets done. And maybe you've heard this poem before about procrastination. It says, "Procrastination is my sin. It only caused me sorrow. I know I ought to change my ways. In fact, I will tomorrow." Right? You got that one. So if someone asks you to define sin, what would you say? You probably would start off something like this. Well, sin is doing something contrary to God's laws, right? And you would say, well, you know, it's wrong to lie, to cheat, to commit adultery, to murder, all those kind of things, right? Where it's wrong to do that. It's a sin, right? Those are sins of commission. But there also are what's called sins of omission. Things that you are omitting, that you are not doing. And so, I can do nothing and still sin. Because there are some things that I ought to do, but if I'm not doing them, then that's sin. Some of you may have grown up in a legalistic church where, your spiritual maturity is kind of measured by what you don't do, right? So you, when I was a kid, you know, one of the sayings that we had, it was a kind of a silly saying, it says, I don't drink, smoke, cuss, or chew, or run around with girls that do, right? And so we measured our spiritual maturity by what we didn't do. And some people actually think that that's what Christianity is. Like, the better you are as a Christian, the less you do. And if that's the case, then dead people would be great Christians, right? Because they don't do anything, But that's not at all what Christianity is all about. there are some things that we ought to do, and when we don't do them, we are actually sinning. So the Bible says that if we put things off, if we procrastinate on those things that we should do, we are sinning. Procrastination really is one of those subtle traps. You know, we say things like, someday I'll get around to it, or one of these days. We are presuming upon the future when we say those kind of things. And really, God wants us to say, today's the day. I mean, one of these days I'm going to commit myself to Christ. One of these days I'm going to get baptized. One of these things I'm going to get serious. And God says there's no guarantees of tomorrow. So what is the solution? The solution to this is to do it now. Proverbs 3, 27 and 28. Do not withhold good from those who deserve it when it's in your power to help them. If you can help your neighbor now, don't say, come back tomorrow and then I'll help you. So in other words, if somebody comes to you and they need help, and it's within your power to help them now, don't say later. Do it now. Do it now. There's a story that Jesus told about a man, a master, who was going on a long trip, going away for quite some time, and he wanted to give his servants charge over his money. You probably know the story as the parable of the talents, and the talent is just simply a weight. And so for the first servant, he gave 5 bags of silver, and to the second servant, he gave 2 bags of silver, and the third servant, he gave 1 bag of silver. And the man went away for this trip. And when he came back, he talked to the servants, and the first 2 servants actually doubled the amount of money that he had given them. And yet the third servant didn't do anything at all about it. He buried it in the ground. And the master responds by saying this, you wicked and lazy servant. You wicked and lazy servant. Why? Because he did nothing. The servant was wicked because he did nothing. So doing nothing with your life is bad. And so whatever you do, whatever you are intending to do for the Lord, do it now. Don't wait till next week. Don't wait till next month. If you're thinking about getting baptized, today is a great day because we're actually having baptism classes today. If you're thinking about inviting someone to church, do it now. If you're thinking about starting to tithe and you want to give back to the Lord, do it now. If you're thinking about being a part of a life group, don't wait. Do it now. Whatever you are intending to do for God, don't delay. Do it now. In Luke chapter 12, Jesus tells this story that's on the screen there. He's telling a story about a man who was very successful, but was also very foolish. In fact, he committed all 3 of these mistakes that James is talking about. The mistakes of how he planned without God, how he presumed about tomorrow, and he put off doing good. This is the story in Luke chapter 12. Let me read it. Then he told him a story. A rich man had a fertile farm that produced fine crops. And he said to himself, what should I do? I don't have room for all of my crops. Then he said, I know. I'll tear down my barns and build bigger ones. Then I'll have room enough to store all my wheat and other goods. And I'll sit back and say to myself, my friend, you have enough stored away for years to come. Now take it easy. Eat, drink, and be merry. But God said to him, you fool, you will die this very night. Then who will get everything you worked for? Yes, a person is a fool to store up earthly wealth, but not have a rich relationship with God. I want you to notice this passage and notice how many times this guy says, I. I think it's highlighted in red. If you go to the next, yeah, there it is. It's red. If you can see it with your clearly there. But he says the word I or my 8 times in these short verses. This guy has an eye problem. right? All he can see is himself. That's all that he's thinking about in this whole plan that he wants to do for the future. And God says, what a fool you've been. You have no idea how long you're going to live. Now again, this story is not meant to place fear into your life. This is not meant for you to lay awake all night wondering if tonight is your last night here on this earth. But God wants you to give your life up to Jesus. Not so that you can be ready if you die tonight, but so that you can live for tomorrow. When you give your life to God, you truly live. You have real life. So it's true that none of us know how long we're going to live here on this earth. But that doesn't mean that we shouldn't plan. But when we do plan, we should remember these three things. Remember to include God in all of your plans, to talk to him first. Don't presume on tomorrow, but live each one day at a time. And don't put off doing good. Do it now. 2 Corinthians 6:2 says, right now God is ready to welcome you. Today he is ready to save you. When is the best time to meet with God? Today. God is ready today. So the question that we have before us then is, what are our plans for the future? What are your plans? And have you talked to God about it? Are you saying, oh, by the way, God, here are my plans. Can you please bless them? We got to stop doing that. I think about that every time I make an agenda for a meeting that I'm preparing or that I'm leading, and I think to myself, you know, God, can you please bless this agenda? No, I need to be in conversation with him ahead of time. God, what do you want me to bring into this meeting? And so what are your plans for retirement? Have you talked to God about it? What are your plans for education? What are your plans for your marriage? Have you talked to God about who you want to marry? Who you are dating? Maybe you're even talking about divorce. Have you talked to God about all of these plans? Do you think that God cares? Absolutely he does. He cares about your life. And the Bible says it's foolish for us to live as though God doesn't care or that God doesn't exist, and we're making all these plans without consulting him whatsoever. Do you talk to God about your business, about your career change, about investments, about how you spend your money? We need to involve God in every area of our life. Check in with him first. And don't take tomorrow for granted. We do that in so many ways, even in the way we'll always have time later to spend time with the kids because, you know, right now we're just so busy trying to make ends meet. We know that that's a false kind of a statement because the decisions that we make today often lead to a lifestyle for a long time. So we do this in so many ways, how we presume. Even collecting debt in our life is presuming upon tomorrow that there'll be better days ahead. We'll be able to pay it off. Don't take tomorrow for granted. Live each day without presuming. Maybe there's something in your life that you know you ought to do, but you haven't done it. You know it's the right thing, but you've been putting it off. Someday I'll get to it, you say to yourself. James says, do it now. Don't wait. Don't delay. Don't say, someday I'm going to give myself over to God. Why not today? There's no better time. Let's spend some time in prayer together. Thank you, God, as you have reminded us, today is a day that you have welcomed us. And so if you're sitting here this morning and you've never opened your life to Jesus, you can do that right now. I invite you to consider doing that even now. You can simply pray something like this. God, I want you in my life. I admit that I've been running my own life, that I've been making my own decisions, and quite frankly, I've made a mess of my life. And I ask for forgiveness for that. And I ask that you come into my life and that you take charge. That you be the boss of my life. And that you would lead me in the direction of my life. There are others of you here this morning that you are a believer, and you would say, yes, I'm a Christian. I've got God in my heart, but quite frankly, there are examples in my life where I've kind of forgotten about God, where I haven't included him. I've left him out. I go to church, but I don't always consult him in the day-to-day decisions of my life. He doesn't always have priority at work or in my family or in my marriage or at school. And so some of you may want to pray something like this: Lord, help me not to plan without you. I want you in my plans. I want to know what your will is. And so, Lord, help me to live one day at a time. Help me to plan for tomorrow, but to live in today, to not worry and to trust in you. And Jesus, help us to stop putting things off, what we know we ought to do, but we put it off for tomorrow and the next day. Maybe it's to serve at church, or maybe it's to get help with a problem, or maybe it's to restore a relationship. Whatever it is in your life right now that you've been delaying, God, help us to act on it, what you've called us to do. Father, help us to trust you more. Help us to depend on you so much, rather than our own ability, rather than our own ingenuity, for we realize that you hold the future. The future is in your hands. Ultimately, you're the one that determines. And so, to be in your hands is really to be in the safest place. And so we thank you for that tremendous promise. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, we're going to take some time to have a Q&A if you want to discuss, have a conversation about what you've been hearing, what has God been saying to you, and any questions that you might have. John has a microphone and ready to run to you.
More of a comment. You know, you listen to this and it's instruction, but my mind went back to God and the children of Israel, and when he gave manna, and he gave them just enough for today. So that's his trade as well. He practiced it, not just here's some ideas, but he actually did the same.
Yeah, thank you. Live one day at a time. Beautiful.
Do you think that the trend over the centuries of increasing self-sufficiency or belief in self-sufficiency and lack of dependence on God, part of that is due to the fact that the intelligence God has given us, the ingenuity God has given us, has enabled us to have the facade of being able to do marvelous things. We can go to the moon, we can do all kinds of things. We don't need to worry about lack of food because we have grocery stores and so on and so forth. But in fact, it's still a precarious life. It's just not as obvious.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, those are kind of questions that philosophers would love to respond to as well, because there probably are a lot of different reasons why there's an increase in the individualistic kind of thinking in the last few decades. But I think self-sufficiency has been around for forever, right? I mean, there's been the attitude that we have the capabilities. I mean, the Tower of Babel was all about that, right? That's going back right to the beginning of time. But I think in Western culture, there is more of an individualistic kind of mindset that we have. And we're relying upon ourselves as opposed to the community. And when we lose that, we lose a sense of what God has intended for us to develop a sense of dependence not only upon him, but upon one another. We've lost that as well. So now it's all about me, right? And it's caused us to totally forget about God. There's probably a bigger question behind all of that that I wouldn't be able to answer completely here today. Is there anything else? Yes.
I don't know if my questions fit in right now, but Salma and I, we missed church for Sundays. We're back, and it's nice to be back.
Welcome back.
One doesn't know the future. I was shifted to the hospital, a different room. I said, that's nice. Then Selma said, you know you're sharing a room with Art Coates. I said, oh, he'll be next to me in that little room. Well, it was not a very good meeting. He was in his agony, you know. Sometimes we go through difficult times, and he did. As you know, this fella, I know him when I was 15 and he was with 18. Now he doesn't have any feet. Doesn't have any feet. He looks healthy, but no feet. And he was going through hard times. But after chatting different things, going back years when we were camping down at Carlsbad, Arizona, came back, and they told us, they let you know in the hospital, you know, close up. So I said, Art, I guess I have to go to my bed, you know. I was sleeping next to him, only a curtain between two of us. So, Art, let's pray it. Like in the olden days, you know, we used to camp. I said, let's just pray. First I prayed, then Art prayed. No, this fella, he didn't have any feet. He next beside me. He prayed, I prayed. Both were very thankful. God is good, even though in his pain.
Yeah.
But as you say, you only have a chance, you don't know the future. Anyway, in an hour's time, not even, I was moved out of the room because they thought my cough wasn't very healthy. And they tried to keep Art, protect him from any, he didn't need anything else. So anyway, out she shifted me. Later on, I wanted to go back into the room. I was told I could not go into the room unless I wore a face mask. I could not, anyway, I had my restrictions, and he was over there, and I wanted to chat with him yet a little bit. But we had prayed together. He stayed there. I went to the next room, and we have met since yet, you know, because I'm waiting my own health to clear up. But what I want to say is, you don't know the future. You don't know. See, I only was with Art, 3 hours, four, maybe, and then I was shifted out and told not to go in there anymore. Strict orders. And these nurses, they know how to enforce things. Anyway, here I am. I'm very thankful that I'm here. You're nice folks.
Yeah.
I like you guys. But now and then, my mind goes back to Art. I have to get myself cleared out, and then I want to go and see him wherever he is. Apparently he, well, he's between Caleb the hospital and Freeport. So either way, he's here. But anyway, it's nice to be here.
Thank you, Gary. We're glad that you're here, and I like you too, so I'm glad that we can celebrate that.